يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا.
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سورة الأعراف is a beautiful surah, like the entire Quran. Every surah has its uniqueness in it, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Qur'an. Every verse is a miraculous thing. Every surah has certain objectives, things for us to reflect upon, for us to learn from the words of Allah. It gives us the real life on the face of earth. People without the Qur'an, they're not really living. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them dead. And unless we put the effort to learn the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an, we will be like them. So that's why we need to receive the proper life, the ruh of this life, the spirit of this life, is by learning the Book of Allah. The Book of Allah, the Quran, makes us see things in the right way. That a person would never be deceived if he reads the Quran and understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us in the Quran. Human beings are deceived. Human beings are in darknesses unless they are guided by the light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the Quran and the Sunnah, the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. One of the things that the human beings are really confused about unless they return to the Book of Allah is matters of what's permissible, what's not permissible, what's right and what is wrong, and the matters of the hereafter, and how there are people that are saved and people that are wretched. This is the reality of this life. Some people will be saved and some people will be wretched. Some people upon the truth and some people upon the falsehood. This is the reality of this life. So it is not sufficient for a person, it is not permissible for a person to live one's life heedless, following the desires and that's it. But rather we have as human beings in each and every one of us this need to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And we believe that no one on the face of earth, unless there's moments in his life where he will be given this to himself, you need to think of what you're here for. You need to search for the truth. You need to be upon the truth. And some people, they choose to follow their desires and to continue to be intoxicated. And those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save are those who take the matter serious and they would repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll see how this concept and this understanding is mentioned in some verses in Surah Al-A'raf and the outcome of one's actions and what's going to happen in the Day of Judgment, to come back with this belief, to live our life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. We'll go through, inshallah ta'ala, verses number 35 to 37. 35, 36, 37 from Surah Al-A'raf, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless it for us and for us to have the proper knowledge to follow. Let's start with verse number 35. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the children of Adam, as it's mentioned before in Surah Al-A'raf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Bani Adam, imma ya'tiyannakum rusulun minkum yaqussuna alaykum ayati faman ittaqa wa aslaha fala khawfun alayhim wa la hum yahzanun. Which means, O children of Adam, if there come to you messengers from among you relating to you my verses, then whoever fears Allah and reforms, there will be no fear concerning them, nor will they grieve. So this is a call from the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator of Adam and his offsprings, our creator subhanahu wa ta'ala, our sustainer, our provider, the most just, the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most forbearing, the one that he knows everything, the one that is in power, the one that has all of the power and no power except by the power of Allah. He subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the children of Adam. So this call is for each and every one of us. It's for everybody. It's for the believers and the disbelievers, for people to understand exactly the message from the Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Bani Adam, إِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ. That means, if there come to you, إِمَّا, that means every time, if it come to you, يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ, comes to you for sure, no doubt. رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ. رُسُل is the plural of رَسُول, means messengers. Messengers come to you from among yourselves. مِّنْكُمْ, from among yourselves. That's why the messengers are sent from the people. They're not angels, they are human beings. And every messenger was sent to his people. And there were many messengers sent to Bani Israel from Bani Israel, one of which is Musa alayhi salam, Jesus the son of Mary. He was from Bani Israel. He was only sent to Bani Israel. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, the final messenger of Allah, was sent to all mankind. So he's a human being. He is the best of all of the human beings. Every single human being on the face of earth can relate themselves to the Prophet ﷺ. They can learn from him. Nobody would ever have that excuse to say, well, it was a different culture, different language, all of this. This is not valid. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as the final messenger of Allah, and he has to speak a language. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the Arabic language to be the final revelation from Allah, and it's very explicit, very clear, no ambiguity in it, and for people to follow the example of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's why the religion of Islam, and how beautiful and perfect it is, it fits every single human being on the face of earth. It's so universal that everybody can be a Muslim and follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ, and they would keep their cultures and they would keep their ways of doing things as long as it's not opposing the orders of Allah and what makes human beings obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the children of Adam that if a messenger come to you, if messengers from among you, they come to you doing what? يَقُصُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ. They narrate, they are relating to you his verses, the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're reciting unto you the verses of Allah. يَقُصُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ. يَقُصُّون from القصص, from story, from relating things, from narrating things to you. That's what the job of the messengers are. The messengers in this life among the human beings, a king, he would send a messenger, he's conveying what the king is saying. The messenger is not inventing his own statements, but rather he is sent by the king. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the owner of all things, he sent messengers as human beings, because that's what makes perfect sense. We need someone from among the human beings for us to understand and to relate to. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send messengers from among ourselves, يَقُصُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ, so they would narrate to you, whether it's stories, rulings, orders, whatever there is. Ayati, verses. The ayat of Allah. It's translated as verses, but the same word is used for the signs of Allah. So this is also true. And the verses of the Quran, they are all signs from Allah. The same way that there are universal signs, the sun, the moon, ourselves. This is all miraculous signs that shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And the more we think to the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more our iman should increase, that everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not created by chance. This is created with great wisdom, by the justice of Allah, by the mercy of Allah. And we have the recited ayat. This Qur'an, the same way we need to look into the heavens and the earth and to see the creation of Allah and increase our iman, we need to look into the words of Allah, the Qur'an. We need to seek guidance from the verses of the Qur'an, from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, this is with the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So every time a messenger comes from among yourselves, يَقُصُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ, they relate to you, they recite unto you the verses, the signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what happened? فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحْ. Two groups. People split when a messenger is being sent. Messengers are tests for the people. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet والسلام, as reported by Imam Muslim in his Sahih, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet والسلام, that he sent him لِيَبْتَلِيَكَ وَيَبْتَلِي بِكَ, so that he would test you and test people with you. A test for the Prophet والسلام, and testing people with regards to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they recite unto them the signs from Allah, the verses of Allah, And there are two groups as a result of that. The believers, and they're mentioned in this verse. And then the next verse will talk about those who are wretched, those who are ruined, those who would receive the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. So, فَمَنْ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحَ مَنْ اتَّقَى Whoever اتَّقَى اتَّقَى, this is the verb of التَّقْوَى. And we know التَّقْوَى to be obedient to Allah, to shield yourself from the punishment of Allah, to fear Allah, to be obedient to Allah, to purify oneself from the sins, to have the taqwa of Allah. And that shows the importance of the taqwa. And there is no way for a person to have the taqwa unless a person follows the way of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, because he said, أَنَا أَتْقَاكُمْ لِلَّهِ I'm the most among you that have taqwa or fear of Allah and obedient to Allah. فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحْ أَصْلَحْ means from الصلاح, to be righteous, to be upright, to be rectified. So whoever has the taqwa of Allah, the fear of Allah, and to be obedient to Allah and so on, وَأَصْلَحْ, that means he is reformed and he reformed others, and he is upright and he make others upright, and he rectifies and reforms whatever is not straight, whatever is not upright, and so on. فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحْ So this is, even though الصلاح is part of the meaning of taqwa, but this is extra, more specific to the what is meant by a taqwa. So this is mentioning something in general and then something in specific. So to be or to rectify or to reform, that's why the religion of Islam is such a powerful way of life, because it orders the believers, the human beings, to be upright and to enjoin good and forbid evil. It opposes al-fasad or corruption. It makes people fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and live a goodly life, a life that is away from injustice and oppression and wickedness and so on. And that's why the enemies of the truth, they would always oppose this truth. So فَمَنِ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحَ Those who have the taqwa of Allah, and with all what that means and the details of that, is our job to learn. And this is not something that we can get from just one ayah, because we need to read the Qur'an. We need to learn what is the meaning of taqwa, how to be among the muttaqeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the characteristics of the people of taqwa. We need to have the concern to learn their characteristics and to be patient to apply it. وَأَصْلَحْ And to have the salah and the uprightness and so on and so forth. What happens to them in the hereafter? فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَهُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ Two things which is repeated in the Qur'an, and we heard it before. No fear for them. فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ No fear. And they should not grieve. But the word فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ is different than saying they should not fear. So it's not like a verb or an action from them. It's more stable. It's more certain. Which means there is no fear. Fear is not going to be for them whatsoever. They are saved from this. It's not an action that might happen sometimes and doesn't happen other times. No, there is no fear for them. It's not present. فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ No fear for them. وَلَهُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ And nor they shall يَحْزَنُونَ يَحْزَنُونَ Grieve. And the fear and the grief are mentioned, because once a person is away from fear and grief, this is the ingredient for happiness. Because الخوف or fear is usually for what's coming ahead, something in the future. And as human beings, what makes us sad and miserable is the worry about the future. We don't know what the future is carrying. A person fears something harmful is going to happen in the future, so his life becomes disturbed. And al-huzn or walahum yahzanun, grieving about something happened in the past. So when a person is secure from both, the future is secured and the past is no grief with regards to the past, that means this person is a happy one. And these two things are mentioned in the Quran, especially at the moment of death, which is the most fearful, the most sad moment. When a person thinks about death, it brings sadness, whether it happens to the person himself or to others. So that moment of death, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the fear and grief, because this is the moment when the believers would receive the ultimate happiness. It will be said to them, no fear for them of what's coming ahead, the hellfire and so on, and nor they shall grieve of what they're leaving behind, their families, their children and so on. To worry about them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their protector. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more of who is saved and who is wretched, as mentioned in the Quran, after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
محمد رسول الله محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back, and with verses in Surah Al-A'raf from number 35 to 37 that talks about those who will be saved among the people of Jannah and those who are wretched, those who will be in the hellfire. Something in the hereafter, something very serious. The entire life is going this way. We're all returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the heedless one is the one that occupies himself with what's not benefiting, following the desires, when we know that death is coming. And after this death is either Jannah or the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear. There's no ambiguity whatsoever. If a person wants to know the characteristics of the people of the hellfire, it's well explained in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The characteristics of the people of Jannah, well explained. And then our duty is to have this knowledge and then to follow the good characteristics and to stay away from what is evil. And we always relate the verses to one another. What's mentioned before about haram and halal, what's permissible, what's not permissible. This is how to live our life if we want to save ourselves. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَحَ. Those who have taqwa, the fear of Allah, to be obedient to Allah, to purify oneself from the sins, and aslah, reforms oneself and others, there's no fear for them, nor shall they grieve. And as we heard, it's for the future and the past, and also at the moment of death. So why would a person then worries? And this is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. So there's no need for a person to panic or to be terrified or to have the heart attached to other than Allah or to think that other than Allah can benefit you or push away harm from you. We only seek rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear Him alone and we are obedient to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about those who are wretched, those who are punished in the hereafter. What are their characteristics on the face of earth? Verse number 36, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا عَنْهَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Which means, but the ones who deny our verses and are arrogant toward them, those are the companions of the fire. They will abide therein eternally. So after mentioning the people of taqwa and those who reform, and there's no fear for them, nor shall they grieve, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the opposite. And that's why this Quran is mathani. That means it mentioned the thing and the opposite of it. And the benefit of knowing whatever things and the opposite of it is that the matter becomes very clear. You have the entire spectrum of things. So the person will be able to choose what is right and to stay away from what is evil. That's how as human beings we function this way. When you want to, and this is a way even to raise our children, for us to be upright and so on. It is not sufficient just to talk about what is good. We have to mention the opposite, to warn ourselves, to stay in what is good. If a person says that to be honest is good, to be truthful is good, you know, a person might come after that and bring all kinds of benefits for lying, for example. We have to warn against what is opposite of what is good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after mentioning the believers, He says, وَالَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. Those who deny, كَذَّبُوا, from al-kadhib, lying. So they deny, they say it's a lie to the ayat of Allah, to the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Qur'an. The ayat of Allah, as we said before, are of two types. The universal ayat, the physical materialistic things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, and the recited ayat. And they're both ayat from Allah because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the heavens and the earth, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke the Qur'an. So the universal ayat, no disbeliever would deny it, meaning that nobody would say, I don't like the air to breathe or the food to eat to sustain our life. Everybody, you know, they have this level of submission to the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they deny it when they do not become grateful to Allah, when they do not relate things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of all things. They eat the food that Allah created, they breathe the air that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, but then they don't follow the other ayat of Allah, which is the religious ayat of Allah, the revelation from Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying those who deny these ayat, they are disbelievers. And that's why denying one ayah, if a person deny one verse in the Quran, one verse only, he's a disbeliever, because it's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore we have to make sure that we submit ourselves to the orders of Allah. Denying meaning to say that this ayah is not from the Quran, for example. You know, a person knowingly, this is an act of disbelief, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the entire Quran from the beginning to the end, and there's no differences whatsoever. And the same thing with something that is already known in matters of religion, mentioned in the Quran or the authentic sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade adultery. Whoever says that adultery is permissible, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forbid it. If he has the knowledge that this is something in the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, this is a matter of disbelief. Why? Because he's denying something that is already well established in the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Or curses the sahaba radiallahu anhum when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them in the Quran and the like of this. So those who deny the ayat of Allah, they say it's a lie, they say this is not the truth and so on, the disbelievers. And wastakbaru anha, and they have kibr, arrogance. Anha meaning referring to the ayat of Allah. They are arrogant to follow the verses of the Quran. And that shows the root of the problem. They did not deny the truth because it doesn't make sense to them. By Allah, this is not the case. They did not deny the truth because it's falsehood. Of course not, that's the truth. Why did they deny the truth after it's been explained to them clearly? It's because of arrogance in their heart. And arrogance can ruin everything. A person, because of arrogance, he would know that he is leading himself to the hellfire, and he would continue to be upon that evil and false path because of the arrogance in the heart. It's such a fatal disease that can ruin a person unless a person repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the sin that Iblis, Shaytan, as it's mentioned previously in the verses in Surah Al-A'raf, he refused to make sujood to Adam alayhi salam when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them, because of that kibr, because of this arrogance. And because of that, he will be in hellfire forever because of this arrogance. And that's why this arrogance, it's not permissible to be present in the heart, even if it's the smallest amount of it. It's something that is forbidden totally. Person has to purify his heart from even the weight of a mustard seed of kibr. As the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, مَنْ كَانَ فِي قَلْبِ مِثْقَالُ ذَرَّةٍ مِّنْ كِبْرٍ. Whoever has in his heart the weight of a mustard seed of kibr, arrogance, كَبَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى وَجِهِ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him fall on his face in the hellfire. Because Jannah, paradise, is the place of those who have no kibr, arrogance inside of their hearts whatsoever. Arrogance has more than one form. And that's why this knowledge is something very important for us. Arrogance is not just one form, it has more than one form. One of the forms of arrogance, as all human beings, they can relate to this, is to be arrogant towards other human beings, to belittle human beings, and to look down upon them because they don't look like you, because they have a different color of their skin, because they're born in a different land, and so on. This is all arrogant. A person is being, or think that he's superior. This is arrogance. But also arrogance, as the Prophet ﷺ defined it, بَطَرُ الْحَقِّ وَغَمْتِ النَّاسِ, to reject the truth, that's arrogance. And we have to be extremely careful with this. The truth, once a person gets to know the truth, he should humble himself to the truth. Sometimes when we are in arguments and someone would say something to us opposite to what we have said, and we realize that this is the truth of what he said. He said what is right. Some people, they would not accept it. Why? Because of the arrogance in the heart. They don't want to be defeated. They don't want to look like they know less. So they would continue with their arguments to oppose and to push away the truth. And the same thing when the truth is being presented. When the truth is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of the heavens and the earth, and he sent messengers to call people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, so follow the messengers of Allah. This is the truth. When someone denies this truth, that means there's arrogance in the heart, because it fits the nature of every single human being. So those who deny the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا عَنْهَا, they have arrogance with regards to the verses of the Quran, the deen of Allah. And as a rule in the tafsir of the Quran, even though the verse is talking about disbelievers, but the characteristics, if there is some of these characteristics applies for a Muslim, but in the level of al-Islam, in the category of Islam, meaning, of course, if a person deny the ayat of Allah, this is takes a person outside the fold of al-Islam, but kibr, someone that has arrogance. He's a Muslim, but he's arrogant. He rejects some of the truth. This is a very dangerous one, but it doesn't take him necessarily outside the fold of al-Islam. So here the people of the Hellfire, those who deny the truth, and they have arrogance towards the ayat of Allah, to the verses of the Quran, to the deen of al-Islam. أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ أُولَٰئِك, indeed, those are the ones, أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ, they are the owners of the hellfire, the companions of the fire. And the word أَصْحَاب, that means they never leave it. They are أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ, you know, like the owner of a house. This is their place that they would be in forever. هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ, they will abide therein, خَالِدُونَ, eternally. No end to it. By the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in these two verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the people of Jannah, those who are saved, and those who are wretched, the people of the Hellfire. What are the characteristics? Taqwa, to have the fear of Allah, to have as-salah, to be reformed others, to upright, and that comes with knowledge, to know the deen of Allah, to be obedient to Allah. And we have the proper knowledge, so that a person doesn't fall into some form of deviation and so on. And what are the characteristics of the people of the Hellfire? They deny the ayat of Allah, they deny the verses of the Quran, they would say that this is not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they have arrogance towards these ayat, and they don't humble themselves and submit themselves to the orders of Allah. They are the people of the Hellfire, they will be in it forever because they died in that state of disbelief, unless they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about also such an evil crime of these people, those who will be in hellfire, because of their evil crime that they committed, one of the worst of the sins as mentioned before, to say about Allah without knowledge, to lie about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, to invent a lie, to say that this is the religion of Allah. When people are upon religions, the sincere and simple question, where did you get your religion from? Where is that this is from Allah? If a person follows the messenger of Allah, do you have a proof that this is what your messenger said? And it's by the mercy of Allah, there is no way for anyone to go back and really find out what the messengers of Allah said, except the final messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it easy for the people, that you cannot make your own religion, you cannot invent your religion. It has to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the job of the messengers of Allah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the believers to follow it and to be obedient to Allah and to be warned against those who commit one of the worst evil actions, and that is to say about Allah without knowledge or to lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verse number 37, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا أَوْ كَذَّبَ بِآيَاتِهِ أولئك ينالهم نصيبهم من الكتاب حتى إذا جاءتهم رسلنا يتوفونهم قالوا أينما كنتم تدعون من دون الله قالوا ضلوا عنا وشهدوا على أنفسهم أنهم كانوا كافرين. Which means, and who is more unjust than one who invents about Allah a lie or denies his verses? Those will attain their portion of the decree until when our messengers come to them to take them in death. They will say, where are those who you used to invoke besides Allah? They will say, they have departed from us, and will bear witness against themselves that they were disbelievers. فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. It's a question that the answer is well established. That's one of the ways to extract the truth from the tongues or from the speech of your enemy or from the other side. Who is more unjust? That means there's no one is more unjust than what is mentioned in the verse. فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ, who is more unjust? مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا, than someone افْتَرَى. افْتَرَى means invented with evil that he forged and invented something, افترى على الله, that he invents about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, كذباً, a lie, أو or كذب بآياته, or he denies his verses. So two things, to claim or to invent a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son, it's a lie. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no son, and no daughter, and no wife. Nothing is the like of Allah. Or to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَ, and the like of this. So denying or inventing a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَوْ كَذَّبَ بِآيَاتِهِ, or to deny the ayat of Allah, the verses of Allah. Two evil actions. What happens to them? We will just we'll talk about it, inshallah ta'ala, after the break. So stay with us, inshallah.
محمد رسول الله محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. With verse number 37 from Surah Al-A'raf, and it talks about there's no one more unjust than someone that would invent a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We talked about some of the examples of this, which is basically our religions, except the deen of Islam. When people invent a lie, they say that Allah said, or a messenger of Allah said, without having the proof of this, without really that this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. Or deny the verses of Allah, deny the truth, the Quran. What happens to them? أُولَٰئِكَ يَنَالُهُمْ نَصِيبُهُمْ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. These people, يَنَالُهُمْ, would afflict them, نَصِيبُهُمْ min al kitab, nasibuhum, their share, nasib is share, from the book. From what book? It's basically the book of the qadr of Allah, the decree of Allah. That means whatever is decreed about them will be established. They will attain what has already been in the decree of Allah, that they are among those who are wretched. That means they would be among those who are already mentioned in the book of Allah, the decree of Allah, by lawh al mahfuz, by the sacred tablet in the qadr of Allah, that they are among those who are wretched, they are among those who are the people of the hellfire. So they will attain their portion, and that's what nasib means, from the decree of Allah, from the book of the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They brought it to themselves, they made themselves like this, and it's all by the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُولَٰئِكَ يَنَالُهُمْ نَصِيبُهُمْ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. They would attain or have upon themselves their share of the book of the decree of Allah, that they are among the people of the hellfire. حتى إذا جاءتهم رسولنا, that means until our messengers. Our messengers here refers to the angels of death. Till our messengers, the angels of death, they come to them, يتوفونهم, that means to take them in death. يتوفونهم, meaning that they would make them dead. The angels of death, they come to them to take their souls, so they will continue to be in such an evil state, and they did not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if they repented to Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiver, and He would forgive them. But they continued to be in that state of disbelief and denying the truth and so on, till the angels, they come to them, the angels of death, they come to them, قالوا أينما كنتم تدعون من دون الله. The angels would say to them, أين, where? أينما كنتم تدعون, where the ones that used to invoke, تدعون, دعاء, من دون الله, other than Allah. These idols, these images, whether it's an image of a prophet or the mother of a prophet or anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Statues, idols, images, anything that is invoked besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether there's an image or there's no image, going to the graves of the righteous ones and invoking them besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where are they? The angels would say to them, where are they to help you? Where are the ones that used to invoke and worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? قَالُوا ضَلُّوا عَنَّا. They would say, meaning these disbelievers, those who invented lies about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they denied the truth, they would say, ضَلُّوا عَنَّا. Dallu means they are gone, they departed from us, we can't find them, they're lost. That's why when a person is lost, they say dal, that means he's not necessarily deviant. The same word is used for deviation, which is, you know, one of the meanings of to be lost. When someone is going to a specific direction, then he's lost on the way. He's dal. That means he needs some guidance. So قَالُوا ضَلُّوا عَنَّا, they are departed from us. We don't know where they are, because they were nothing. They made gods besides Allah. So they come in the moment of death, and afterwards, they're not gods. They're not the ones that would help them then. قَالُوا ضَلُّوا عَنَّا وَشَهِدُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ, and they would witness against their own selves أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا كَافِرِينَ, that they were disbelievers. Such a regret that there's no point of return. There's no return for this regret. There's no fixing of that regret. You can imagine someone would have to live with their regret and their misery forever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. He subhanahu wa ta'ala the most just. Messengers after messengers have been sent. No excuse whatsoever. And that's why once the truth is being presented, then a person has to make the matter serious. And this is something that we mentioned many, many times before. And I don't really feel bored of mentioning it again. Because some people, they don't understand, they get offended when there is warning is being mentioned. Warning them with all kinds of sincerity. Warn against shirk and associating partners with Allah. Warn against being not a follower of the Prophet ﷺ and to embrace the deen of Islam and to follow the Quran. The warning is not something in this life that a person is threatened. No, their life will be taken care of, and it's the duty of a Muslim to be kind to others and so on. So there's nothing wrong with that. But in the hereafter, you know, this is what is waiting for them. And we have to warn ourselves also from being among those who deny the verses of Allah and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. But how human beings, they understand warnings very well. And when someone warns them of something harmful that is going to happen to them, they take it serious. Otherwise, they don't blame then anyone but their own selves if the warning is the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning them. And it will be said to them, where are these things that you used to invoke besides Allah? قَالُوا ضَلُّوا عَنَّا, they are departed from us, that we cannot see them. They're away because they were nothing. They were invoking other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they witness against themselves. No one on the face of earth, no one among the human beings whatsoever, in the day of judgment, would say that they didn't know or this or that. They would curse themselves because they already, this is for those who the message reached them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for those who the message didn't reach them, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا, we would not punish till a messenger is being sent. So for those who the messenger is being sent, the truth is being explained to them, and they turn away from it, then they should not blame anyone. The warning is clearly in the Quran. Quran is not like the human beings. We as human beings, we sometimes tend to be deceitful to others. And we think that we are being kind to others when we hide the truth. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He makes the matter very clear. That's how we as Muslims, we should make the matter very clear, straightforward. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran believers and disbelievers. He mentions the truth and falsehood. He mentioned the Jannah and the Hellfire. We need to learn this and we need to be upon this and need to make the matter very clear. And if someone, for example, get offended, if they already disbelieve in the hereafter, why they're being offended? If what's being mentioned is there a punishment in the hereafter, why do they care if they disbelieve in it to start with? Why would they be angry for the one that would say that if you die in that state, you will be among the people of the hellfire in the hereafter? If they don't believe in it, why do they care about it? You see the point here? But the point here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just, and we need to be aware of this, and we need to warn ourselves from what is evil. And that's why the Quran is fasl, is very clear in these matters. It's not ambiguous whatsoever. Why? Because this is the most important thing, matters of tawheed. Religions are not just, or religion is not about being kind and nice and so on. This is part of the religion, and a person has to be kind and so on. But that's not only what religion is for. The religion is the tawheed, is the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, not to associate partners with Him, to follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to stay away from associating partners with Allah, to stay away from sins, to stay away from innovating in the deen, to be patient with this. Otherwise, a person can be easily deviated as a result of turning away from the light, which is the Book of Allah. As we see, many benefits that we learn from this. This is another call to the children of Adam. And this call was given also to Adam alayhi salam, as we heard in Surah Al-Baqarah and others, that every time a messenger comes to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in another part in Surah Al-Baqarah, he said, فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَى, whoever follows my guidance. So al-ittiba', to follow the guidance. What is al-ittiba'? What is to follow the guidance? Since the Quran explains itself, here it's mentioned, فَمَنْ اتَّقَى وَأَصْلَح. This is what it means to follow. To follow guidance is to have taqwa, because that's the goal of the ibadat and the acts of worship. And to be reformed and to reform others, to enjoin good and forbid evil. And that's how sincere a Muslim is towards humanity. He does not leave them like this to lead themselves astray. But if you see someone, if you know someone that is going to harm's way, you should advise that person to the best of your ability, with all kindness and goodness and mercy and so on in one's heart. So we learn from this that the messengers of Allah, one of the pillars of al-Iman is to believe in the messengers of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send messengers. And the final messenger is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To learn that the job of the messengers are to relate to the people the truth. They don't invent anything from themselves, but rather they relate to the people what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to them. And we learn from this that if you want to be among the people of Jannah, to save oneself from the hellfire, we need to have taqwa of Allah. We have to be obedient to Allah. We have to fear Allah. We have to purify ourselves from sins by always repenting to Allah. And to be upon al-islah, to be upright and to enjoin good and forbid evil. We learn that the fear and grieve is something that as human beings we run away from. And the way for us to protect that, then to perfect our life, is to be among the people of taqwa and to reform and so on. Otherwise, the fear and grief can afflict us. And we see that the means of happiness in this life is to do certain things and to stay away from certain things. There are things that we like that we would like to have, and there are fearful things that we want to push away. If someone has all means in this life, but he's grieving about something, he does not enjoy what he has. And if a person is not grieving and not fearing, but he doesn't have anything in this life, he's still not, you know, happy, he's still miserable. So that's why the combination of both, to do certain actions and to be away from what is fearful and brings the grief and so on. There's nothing in the deen of al-Islam that calls us to be in state of grief, but rather we should be happy. And we should enjoin good and forbid evil, but to be serious in this life by being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this verse, it talks about the specifics or the characteristics of the people of Jannah. Is it the only verse in the Quran that talks about this? Of course not. There are many, many verses in the Quran that talks about the characteristics of the believers, the people of taqwa, and our duty is to get to learn this and to follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And then after that, another benefit is about the people of the hellfire. Very specific characteristics are mentioned. Those who deny the ayat of Allah, and those who would have arrogance. Arrogance is something that we have to stay away from. And again, as we said, rejecting the truth, this is what arrogance is all about. And it doesn't mean for a person that if a person likes to wear nice clothing, that's not arrogance. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ, he was asked about that specifically. That a man would like to have nice clothing and nice shoes, is that considered to be arrogant? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, no, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلُ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَلِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful. And he likes what is beautiful. Anything that is beautiful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes that. So why would a person then forbid what is beautiful? As long as it's halal, as long as it's permissible. And not, for example, someone to show their beauty, like a woman showing her beauty to other than her mahrams, for example, this is not permissible. So, but then the Prophet ﷺ, he defined al-kibr or arrogance as rejecting the truth and belittling people. So the truth is our goal in this life. And we have to have that sincerity in our hearts. Once the truth becomes clear, we adopt the truth. Otherwise, al-kibr or arrogance is one of the characteristics of the people of the hellfire. And we believe, as it's mentioned, to believe in the hellfire. And that the disbelievers will be in the hellfire forever. This is a matter of belief. So the belief in the hereafter is mentioned in these verses. And in the hereafter, there is the Jannah and the hellfire. Both are created now. They are present now. They're not going to be created later. And this is the proper belief in the Jannah and the hellfire. And of course, there is an outcome or a benefit to learn or to believe or to have this proper belief. That means whatever a person is doing now, the Jannah is present now, the hellfire is present now. And for example, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, whoever says أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُ وَرَسُولُ, after the making wudu, the gates of Jannah opens. It opens. That means it's present now. And it opens now for a person to relate this to his own self so that he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if he's seeing these matters of unseen. Also, one of the benefits that we learn, that al-dhulm is forbidden from an adlam, forbidden at all levels. There's no such a thing of an exception to permit injustice whatsoever. And one of the worst acts of injustice, as we heard, is to invent a lie about Allah, is to say something about Allah that is not true, to say something of a lie. And that's why, for example, the names and attributes of Allah are only to be known in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. It is not permissible for someone to invent a name for Allah and the other examples that we mentioned. Also denying the ayat of Allah. The belief in the Qadr of Allah is mentioned as a result of the people's actions, which is one of the pillars of al-Iman, the decree of Allah. They believe in the angels of death, as it's mentioned in the verse, and death that is inevitable, and that the evil of idol worshipping and these things that are being worshipped besides Allah will be, it does not exist as a fact, as idols or as partners with Allah. They're not partners with Allah, so they're not going to be there to benefit the people, and people would curse themselves, meaning the disbelievers, in the Day of Judgment. Very straightforward verses. This is the nasiha, this is the concern towards humanity, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the children of Adam to adopt the truth, to follow the truth, the book of Allah, and the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us steadfast on the deen of Allah and to make us among the people of Jannah and to protect us all from the hellfire. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
إلا الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم.
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون.
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام.
شاهدا ومبشرا.